If you were to assemble all the witnesses for the theory of evolution, what powerful evidence would you have? There is another question, though, that needs to be asked also. If you were to assemble all the witnesses that speak against the theory of evolution, what evidence would you have? Stay tuned, and we will look at the witnesses.
Steps to Life is opening God's Word with you.
Jesus is coming again. Are you ready for His soon return?
Jesus Christ is always what we'll share with you.
We need a refreshing, so drink. Jesus is the water of life.
Steps to Life, a work of love, a work of love.
He created this earth and wants to recreate you.
He can change your life.
Thank you for joining us. Before we look at the witnesses in favor, and also there are some witnesses against the theory of evolution. But before we look at the witnesses, we want to pray and ask God to help us find and know the truth. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, we want to know the truth. We earnestly pray that your Holy Spirit may lead us and guide us to an understanding of the truth, and that you will give us a heart to obey and follow the truth. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Creation versus evolution. The debate has been going on for years. Steps to Life will help you sift through what is fact and what is fiction. We would like to send you a free audio cassette of today's program and a free book entitled Mystery in the Rocks. To receive your free gift, simply call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for offer number 105. Have you heard the story of Robert Gentry, a controversial physicist whose strange discovery rocked the scientific world? Call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for offer number 105. And now, Pastor John Grossbaugh.
When the theory of evolution goes to court, what do the witnesses say? In every court trial, there are witnesses. We must have witnesses or we cannot come to an understanding of the truth, whatever issue we are studying. And there are many witnesses in the scientific world today that people point to, scientists point to, and they say this evidence in the natural world points to the fact of evolution. What are these witnesses and what do they say? Well, first of all, there is the witness of the fact that mutations occur. Now, you know what a mutation is. That's when there is some kind of a change in the genetic makeup from one generation to another. And as a result of that genetic change, the daughter or the son is different than the parent because of some mutation. And mutation, these genetic changes, people say after you have many, many, many genetic changes over a period of many millions of years, you can have a change that goes from one form to another form until people say, well, it went from this form to this form to this form to this form, and finally you have mankind. Well, let's take a look at a few facts about mutations. What is the witness from the scientific world about the nature of mutations? Let's just look at a few facts and see if the fact of mutations will back up the theory of macroevolution. Number one, it is estimated that 99% of all mutations are harmful. Did you know that? About 99% of all mutations are harmful. Not only that, about 90%, number two is, about 90% of all mutations are lethal. That means that the person or the thing or the animal or the plant that receives that mutation cannot survive. But macroevolution requires not just one, but a multitude of simultaneous changes resulting from mutations. A multitude of simultaneous changes in an organism. Now, not all mutations are heritable. That means the person or the thing that has the mutation cannot pass it on to the next generation. And not only this, there is not evidence to support the idea that the genetic code will allow these mutations to continue in the same direction in which they began. But most important of all, in regard to mutation and mutation changes, is the fact that mutations have definite limits. Let's explain that. Mutation changes have definite limits that they cannot transgress. For instance, many breeding experiments have been done with fruit flies. But no matter how many breeding experiments you do with fruit flies, no matter how many mutations you discover or find, somehow the fruit fly never changes into a horse fly or a bumblebee. It stays the way it is. Now, you may have different mutational changes. You may have albinos or different colors or something different, a little smaller, a little larger. But it still stays what it is. The same is true with beans. No matter how many times you try to get mutations, you may get many kinds of beans, but you don't get tomatoes or corn. And so mutations have limits. They have limits both as to size and to kind. The world now has been waiting for over one century to find conclusive evidence of even one evolutionary change from one basic kind to another. If this change occurred in many small steps, well, then there should be some evidence of it in the fossil record. And that brings us to our second witness that is supposed to be in favor of the theory of evolution, and that is the record of the fossils. Many people today are completely unaware of the fact that some of the most formidable evidence against the theory of evolution is actually from the fossils that have been found and studied. If evolution were true, then there should be evidence of gradual change from one species to another in the fossil record. But such evidence is lacking. Scientists have been looking for over 100 years for these so-called missing links from one species to another. They're missing both from the world of the present and they're missing from the fossil record. The transitional forms just aren't there. What is there in the fossil record is definite species and groups of species which appear suddenly rather than at the end of a chain of evolutionary links. In fact, the evidence from the fossil record is so strong against the theory of the evolution that did you know that Charles Darwin himself conceded the following? He said that the state of the fossil evidence was the most obvious and the greatest or strongest objection against his theory. The evidence of the fossil record is not in favor of evolution at all. The evidence of the fossil record is in favor of the idea of the immutability of species, that is, the unchangeableness or unchangeable nature of species. You see, the fossil record does not provide us with evidence of one single transition from one species to another. Now, this is surprising to some people because they say, oh, I thought that we had evidence that there were people like the Java man and like the Neanderthal man and these different primitive forms of man, and then they have gradually evolved into modern human beings. Well, let's look at the evidence we have from the fossil record concerning these people, these supposed transitional forms of primitive humans. This is examined in a book called Bones of Contention. And after looking at a great deal of supposed evidence that contradicts other evidence, here are some conclusions from that book that many people have never heard, because for one reason or another, even though it's been around for a long time, somehow it doesn't get published in the textbooks. Here's number one. Did you know that there's strong evidence has been published that so-called Neanderthal man were really modern humans who suffered from rickets and probably also congenital syphilis? Number two, did you know that evidence has existed, in fact was published nearly 100 years ago by evolutionist scientists, that proved that Java man could not possibly have been our evolutionary ancestor, but lived as a contemporary of more modern humans. Many people do not know this. And then there is the so-called transitional form that is called Homo erectus. Did you know that, first of all, these fossils are not distinct enough to warrant being classified as a separate species from modern man? And second, if we use the dating methods and the conclusions of the evolutionists themselves, then these Homo erectus fossils have lived side by side with other categories of true humans for up to nearly 2 million years. And this fact eliminates entirely the possibility that Homo erectus could have evolved into modern humans. And then there are the supposed transitional forms, such as Australopithecus and Java Man, that actually were probably apes with some points of similarity to humans. The tooth ascribed to the Nebraska Man proved to have belonged to an extinct pig. And the Piltdown skull was an absolute hoax. So, when we look at all the evidence, where are we? Do we have even one witness that would definitely show us that there has been evolution from one species to another species over a long period of time? No, we don't have evidence of even one case that is convincing. 130 years or more of determined effort to confirm the theories of Darwinism have done no better than to find a few ambiguous examples. So the fossils provide much more discouragement than support for the theories of Darwinism. Oh, but somebody says, there's the geologic column. That'll prove it. Will it? Well, let's take a look at the geologic column and see what evidence we can find there in favor of the theory of evolution. Stay tuned in just a moment. We'll look at it.
Sometimes studying the Bible on your own without any help or guideline to follow can be a little difficult. And after confusion and frustration set in, we all too often turn to other things. If this sounds like you, you're not alone. The Steps to Life Bible Correspondence School is just the answer. Call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for your free Bible Correspondence Starter Pack.
I really enjoy being able to study at home. I'm a new Christian, and I definitely knew I needed some guidance.
Simply review each lesson and answer the questions.
These studies were great. It just seemed like the Bible opened up for me.
Then send the completed lesson back to us in the envelope provided.
These studies were very professional. They didn't take a lot of time, and I really appreciated that.
A Bible teacher will then look over each lesson and send them back to you with the next set of studies. It's that simple and totally free. Call Steps to Life Television at 1-800-THE-TRUTH.
I'm so glad I called.
Welcome back. The geologic column, many people say, that proves the theory of evolution. Let's take a look at the geologic column. Let me ask you a question and see if you've ever thought of this. Is any geologic column being developed anywhere by sedimentation anywhere in the world today? Is there any sediment being formed on modern ocean bottoms that is going to, over a period of time, produce another geologic column? It has been postulated, we should say it has been assumed, that this column, this geologic column, was laid down over many millions of years. But when we do laboratory experiments, and laboratory experiments have been done on this, to see how does lamination take place, that is, how does rock stratification take place, we find, first of all, that we cannot make any deduction on the duration of sedimentation just by looking at the strata of the rock. We cannot deduct that but just by looking at it. We cannot tell the time that was involved by looking at it. In fact, these experiments on lamination or rock stratification contradict the idea of slow buildup of one layer followed by another. The time scale is reduced from hundreds of millions of years to one or two cataclysms, that is, violent actions of water producing almost instant stratification of rock. Today, there are no known fossiliferous rocks forming anywhere in the world. Did you know that? Nowhere in the world today are there the organic remains of billions of dead creatures becoming slowly buried in sediments and then lithified into fossils. They are simply being eroded by wind and weather and tide and predators. For example, in the United States, some years ago, we had probably 60 million or more buffalo. We had these buffalo right around here in the Great Plains of the United States. And these 60 million or so buffalo have mostly died off. But they have not left any buffalo beds of buffalo fossils. Now, this is actually not at all surprising when you start to think through the conditions that have to exist in order for fossils to be formed. In order for any dead creature to be fossilized, first and most important, it must be very rapidly buried with sediment in order to prevent decay by bacteria or assault by predators or decomposition through wave action or weather or water. And this sediment that buries the dead creature shortly after death has to be of considerable depth to prevent the remains from simply being dispersed by natural processes. And when we look at the fossils, the detail and the completeness with which many fossil specimens are preserved are a clear indication that the creatures were rapidly buried under considerable depths of sediment. The very size of some of these fossil specimens, such as the larger land-living dinosaurs, makes it absurd to suppose that they could have been preserved in just a few millimeters of sediment. So when we look at the evidence of the fossils and compare it with the geologic column where we have the fossils, we find that we do not have any powerful or unequivocal witness at all for the theory of evolution. In fact, the evidence that is supposed to prove it true actually proves that it cannot be true. Now we need to ask another question. These are the witnesses that are supposed to prove that the theory of evolution is true. Are there witnesses that would say that the theory of evolution is not true? Yes, there are. There are very powerful witnesses that say that we came into existence, the world came into existence, and plant and animal life came into existence by a completely different process. When we open the Bible to the very first book, to the very first chapter, to the very first verse, the very first sentence, this is what we read. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The Bible doesn't say that the earth came into existence over a long process of eons of time. It says in the beginning, God created it. And when God came down and spoke His law to the children of Israel on Mount Sinai, He said, I'm the one that made it. And that's why you should worship me. I am the creator. Notice the way the Lord expressed it in the Ten Commandments. This is the only document in the Bible that claims not only to have been spoken by God, but also to have been written by His own finger in tables of stone. It is His law called the Ten Commandments. And right in the heart of the Ten Commandments, God bears testimony and He says, this is the way that the world and everything in it came into existence. Notice what it says. This is what God says in the Ten Commandments. Exodus 20, verses 8 to 11, it says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall do no work, you nor your son nor your daughter, nor your manservant nor your maidservant, nor your cattle, nor your stranger who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested the seventh day.
Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. Notice, God says, I made the heavens and the earth. He's talking about the atmospheric heavens and our solar system. There's three heavens spoken of in the Bible. And the Lord says, I made it in 6 days, and I rested on the seventh day, and that is the memorial of the fact that I created the earth. And if you are my child, I ask you to honor the day that commemorates the creation of the world at creation week. So the first witness is Moses. He witnesses that in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. The second witness is God Himself. He wrote down the Ten Commandments with His own finger. He said, I made the heavens and the earth. I made them in 6 days. And then the third witness are the prophets. Did you know, as you read through the Bible, all the prophets and all the apostles were Sabbath keepers, and therefore that proves that they were acknowledging the creatorship of God. Notice what the prophets say about the origin of the earth. How did the earth come into existence? The prophets are very, very clear about how it happened. Notice what it says in Psalm 33, verses 6 and 9. It says, by the word of the Lord the heavens were made, and all the host of them, by the breath of His mouth, verse 9. For He spoke, and it was done. He commanded, and it stood fast. The Bible says we came into existence, the world came into existence by the word of God. Man was formed, and woman was formed by the hand of God, in the image of God, as it says in Genesis 1, 26 and 27. He spoke, it says, and it was done. Now, we have very good evidence that God can do that because we have the story of Jesus recorded by the apostles. The miracles that He worked in front of hundreds and sometimes thousands of people. And how did He work these miracles? You study the gospel record. He worked the miracles by His word. When He spoke, it was done. So, the first record that we came into existence as a result of the Word of God is Moses. The second witness is God Himself. He bears record in the Ten Commandments written by His own finger in tables of stone that He made us. He made everything in the world. The third witness is the prophets. And then the fourth witness is Jesus Christ Himself. Look at what Jesus said about it. In Matthew, the 19th chapter, people say, oh, the story of Adam and Eve is just a myth to explain the origin. But notice what Jesus Christ thought about the story of Adam and Eve. Matthew 19, verse 4. And He answered and said to them, have you not read that He who made them at the beginning made them male and female? And said, for this reason a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So then they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore what God has joined together, let not man separate. Jesus said, haven't you read about that? Don't you know that He who made them at the beginning made them male and female, just as recorded in the book of Genesis? You see, Jesus upheld the writings of Moses. In fact, notice what Jesus says here in the Gospel of John, the 5th chapter, verses 46 and 47, He said to the Jews, He said, if you believe Moses, you would believe Me, for he wrote about Me. But if you do not believe his writings, how will you believe My words? Jesus said, if you don't believe what Moses wrote, how can you believe Me? You see, if Moses wasn't true, then Christ was a fraud. You cannot be a Christian, a true follower of Jesus Christ, unless you believe in special creation, that He who made them at the beginning made them male and female. They didn't evolve over millions of years. They were made by the hand of God. That's the testimony of Jesus Christ. And then there is the testimony of the apostles of Christ. Notice what Paul says about origins in Colossians, the first chapter, verses 15 and 16. He says, He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation, speaking of Jesus Christ. For by Him all things were created, that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created through Him and for Him. So how is it that there are limits to mutations? Because Jesus Christ put the limitations within the genetic code of every creature that He has made. That's why you can't go from one to another. You can't start from a cat and get to a horse, or go from a bean to a cedar tree. You can't do it. He made each creature to propagate itself, but not to become a different one. And then in Hebrews 1, verses 1 to 3, we have this statement. God, who at various times and in various different ways spoke in time past to the fathers by the prophets, has in these last days spoken to us by His Son, whom He has appointed heir of all things, through whom also He made the worlds, who being the brightness of His glory and the express image of His person, and upholding all things by the word of His power. When He had by Himself purged our sins, sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high. So there you have it. The first witness is Moses. The second witness is God. When He gives the Ten Commandments and writes it in tables of stone, He says, I made everything. The third witness is the prophets. The fourth witness is Jesus Christ Himself. The fifth witness is the apostles. You have to reject all of these witnesses to believe the theory of evolution, because the Bible contradicts it from beginning to end, and you, friend, are going to have to decide, who are you going to believe? Are you going to base your faith and decide your destiny on the basis of human interpretations of bones and sediments and observations of mutations on some moth? The altering of minor characteristics of living things? Or are you going to base your faith on what the Bible says? Oh, somebody says, I can see there are not strong witnesses for the theory of evolution, but how can I know that the Bible is true? Oh, friend, you can know because, number one, Bible prophecy predicts the future before it happens, which no man can do. Number two, because the history of the Bible has been shown to be accurate, and most of all, when you study the Bible and listen to its teachings, it will change your life. I do not know of any life that has ever been changed by the teachings of evolution, but the Bible will change your life if you will listen to it.
We hope you have enjoyed today's prophecy seminar on When the Theory of Evolution Goes to Trial, What Will the Witnesses Say? We would like to send you a free audio cassette of today's program and a free book entitled Mystery in the Rocks. Simply call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for offer number 105. Discover the story of Robert Gentry, a controversial physicist whose strange discovery sparked an amazing odyssey through Pride and Prejudice in the scientific world. This is a story the scientific establishment would like to silence, told in straightforward language the layman can appreciate. Find out for yourself the discovery that rocked the scientific world. Call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and remember to ask for offer number 105. Call 1-800-THE-TRUTH. Tune in next week for When the Theory of Evolution Goes to Trial, Who Will Be the Judge?
Steps to Life.
We hope you have been as blessed by today's message as we have been in bringing it to you. We encourage you to contact us at Steps to Life Ministries with any questions or comments you might have.
Check 1-2. Check 1-2.
Don't forget to ask for today's free offer.
Ready in 5-4.
Steps to Life Ministries, preparing a people for the soon coming of Jesus Christ.
Welcome, friends.
He can change your life.